Other than that, all you have to do is sit back and help.
We'd like to welcome you to our Hop On, Hop Off City Tour, honoring our past, embracing our future. For your safety, please remain seated at all times during our tour today, and please keep your hands and body inside
the first British pioneer settled Victoria in 1843, almost 20 years earlier than Vancouver.
Old Town gives you a chance to meander down a street lined with lovingly preserved Victorian and Edwardian buildings. Trendy yoga studios, fashionable art galleries, and funky coffee shops. Old Town is the perfect place to pick up refreshments, sit in the sun, and enjoy buskers or street performers plying their trade.
You're passing along the street, the city's original name. Throngs of settlers used to take care of business here, buying and selling wares or building up a nest egg at the bank.
In less than 200 years, this spot on Vancouver Island has evolved from the uncharted wilderness that people of the First Nations called home to a rustic British trading post and on to the bustling city you see today. Victoria honors our past with pride.
And we're actually traveling on Wharf Street as Government Street's one block up to here, right? They've actually converted Government into a pedestrian-friendly zone with lots of little added extra patio space for a nice meal outside or an ice cream. But down here on the Wharf is also another excellent place to grab some food and our little Nellie's, which is nice and very safe. Or here in the main corner of British Columbia's Heritage Conservation. We don't just tear down old buildings when we need something new. We preserve their beauty and character, but we refurbish the interiors to bring them up to date. Everything old is new again.
We keep our British traditions alive, but we also welcome a whole world of new experiences.
Fashion boutiques filled with one-of-a-kind creations. Check out the window displays for a look at our local designers' talents. You'll even find several shops with gorgeous clothing made of work.
A brilliant red triple gate with pagoda roofs, called the Gates of Harmonious Interest, marks the entrance to Victoria's Chinatown. You'll get a better look at this gateway when we pass through it in a few minutes. Legend has it that the hand-carved stone lions to either side will spring to life if they're ever needed.
Thousands of men from the Canton province in China came through Victoria in the mid to late 1800s. The gold rush of 1858 lured the first Chinese immigrants here. Later generations came to work in coal mines. Chinese laborers also played a major role in building the transcontinental line of the Canadian Pacific Railway, which united Canada from coast to coast. Some of these newcomers decided to settle permanently in Victoria, and Chinatown was born. This city within a city did a brisk business, with over 150 commercial establishments, including two opera stages. In its heyday, 15,000 Asians lived in Chinatown, as many residents as the European population in Victoria.
Notorious opium parlors and gambling clubs.
San Francisco, I mean, the oldest and the largest.
Just ahead is Victoria.
1980s. But the threat of losing this link to the past galvanized citizens to lobby against the plan. They won the day and saved this landmark, which became the city's first heritage building to be adapted for reuse. It's now part of the Centennial Square Civic Complex, which features an eclectic mix of architectural styles, old and new.
Just past it, you'll see our new City Hall. It stands adjacent to another blend of historic architecture and modern improvements, the McPherson Playhouse. It's one of many cultural venues in our city. We don't have to go to Vancouver to experience the thrill of live performance. Theater, opera, ballet, and live music all thrive in Victoria.
Victoria's community design policies and heritage tax incentive program have won top honors from the Planning Institute of British Columbia and the International Downtown Association.
Thank you.
sign in front of our legislature building. A large green statue. That is a statue of Queen Victoria, whom we're seeking to meet after.
The steamship terminal, this stop. Destinations. Fisherman's Wharf. Octopus, wolf eels, rockfish, giant kelp, and other creatures.
find the provision to be in here. And just across the water to your right there, past that large, should be the ship. This is the other big mountain range.
Right leg.
corner of Highway 1, the world's longest highway, and the Terry Fox Memorial. Beacon Hill Park, Mile Zero, and the Terry Fox Memorial, this stop.
Whether you love to shop or just browse, here on 4th Street you'll find a proud assortment of one-of-a-kind shops and galleries that feature antiques. 4th Street also has cozy coffee shops and top-notch eateries.
Into 144 lots, which they planned to sell separately. But sales were slow, so the Dunsmuir daughters tried a creative loan, but he decided not to move in. Instead, he drew loans against it that he never paid back. So the bank repossessed the castle and sold it to the city. The city kept the property that could use. It housed the military hospital for veterans of the First World War, as well as the military hospital and the Victoria Hospital. It's a museum owned by the Kagana Historical Museum Society.
Thank you.
quilting, fishing, and bird watching trips. If you're a golfer, you can head for the lakes every month of the year.
European heritage. Near the water, for instance, look for touches that remind you of traditional British cottages, like rounded doorways, ornately carved Georgian columns, or diamond-shaped leaded glass windows. All of these details date back to the late 19th century, when it was fashionable to build cottages.
Which specializes in local, sustainable seafood. The marina has spectacular views of the Straits of Juan de Fuca, as well as Mount Baker, a dormant volcano in Washington State. You might also see harbor seals, which hang out at the marina for the same reasons we do, recreation and fresh fish. Seals are incredibly graceful swimmers, but they're comical on land, bouncing along on their bellies and barking. You can also rent bicycles at the marina and arrange for a guided bike tour.
This stop, Oak Bay Marina.
Hop off here to take in the magnificent oceanside views, check out the seals, and take advantage of the marina's many facilities.
Oak Bay Marina, this stop.
Hotel.
Hop
here to experience their historic pub, or grab gourmet treats at the cafe, featuring the original hotel entrance, hand-hewn beams, and a fireplace.
Oak Bay Beach Hotel, this stop.
In time to when Vancouver Island was a pristine wilderness. The original human inhabitants were people of the First Nations, who probably included the ancestors of the first Salish peoples, including the Songhees Nation and the Esquimalt Nation. They lived in a land of plenty, with a temperate climate, calm waters, bountiful fish, good hunting, and abundant edible plants. The island's cedar trees provided raw materials for shelter and even clothing. With all these resources, British Columbia's coastal region was probably one of the most densely populated areas in North America. Later, when British Columbia became part of Canada, indigenous peoples still made up the majority of the population, but contact with European settlers shrank their numbers substantially over the decades to come.
More than 30 different First Nations languages, about 60% of all the Canadian First Nations languages, are part of British Columbia's history. Today, Victoria's Royal British Columbia Museum works with First Nations elders from across Canada to document and preserve these languages. Language provides the key to understanding the true diversity of First Nations history, culture, and values. We'll be right back.
shall see.
Here to walk along the tree-lined streets of this urban village. Indulge in delicious refreshments and soak up the small-town ambiance. Cook Street was named for Captain James Cook, the first European to explore Vancouver Island. Explore Cook Street Village and discover the magic of one of Victoria's gems.
Cook Street Village, this stop.
Culture would vanish soon. She visited First Nations villages in British Columbia, intent on
balance. More than capturing literal reality, her paintings delved into the emotional impact of the world around her. Even when lack of recognition tempted her to give up art altogether, she took joy in her independence and clung to her vision. Emily Carr's fortunes finally changed when she met members of the famous Group of Seven, a band of daringly original modern painters who celebrated the beauty and majesty of the Canadian landscape. At last, she found kindred spirits who understood her vision. In fact, the Group of Seven named Carr the Father of Modern Arts. With their encouragement, she became one of the leading Canadian artists of her time, and one of the only major female artists in North America or Europe. Today, she's a national icon. The house where she grew up.
Just ahead, you'll see a forest of totem poles. This is Thunderbird Park, part of the Royal British Columbia Museum.
Sparked a new wave of interest in totem carving.
You'll find the original totem poles in the museum's First People's Gallery, along with a fascinating collection of artifacts and interactive exhibits that transport you through time and space to experience the history and culture of Indigenous peoples of the Pacific Northwest Coast.
Hey, we're just about back at the Empress Hotel now. Just your left hand side is the one piece of the museum. There's a bell tower. It was a gift to Canada from the Netherlands in 1967. Say thank you for liberating them during World War II. And if we make our final turn here, so on your right hand side is another statue. But this statue is of Emily Carr with her little pet monkey. I'd like to thank you for traveling with Greyline today. Hope you had a great day, great visit. Please come back again. This bus now goes out of service.